Let us learn the chapter development. Now, what do you mean by the term development? Well, it is a process of economic and social advancement in terms of quality of human life. Next, development is also a process of improvement and changes that are required for better living and existence. Now, in this chapter, we shall discuss about economic as well as human development. But we are mainly focusing on human development. And if at all human development has to take place, then the human beings as individuals should have goals. And the goals of individuals differ from one to another. If you take a few examples like landless rural laborer, his goal is better wages, more days of work, local school for children, and no social discrimination. Similarly, if I go for a prosperous farmer from Punjab, he wants high price for the crops, high family income, and hardworking and cheap laborers. Then if I am going for a farmer who depends only on rain for growing crops, he requires, first thing is rain, so it is adequate rainfall. Second, if possible, it is irrigation facility because he can grow multiple crops. So he can grow 2 to 3 crops in 1 year because he has an assured supply of water. Then a rural woman from land-owning family. She needs a share in the family landholding and respect, dignity, and quality education for children. If I take an urban, unemployed youth, he requires a job. So it is employment. Second, not only job, it should be job security. A girl from rich urban family. It will be safe and liberal environment. Second, studies abroad. And third, the brother should contribute. Now, a boy from a rich urban family, he needs carefree life. Next, studies abroad. Adivasi from Narmada Valley. Now, these Adivasis have been fighting over a cause, that is, on the river Narmada, Sardar Sarovar Dam is developed. And because of that, many villages, that is the villages of the Adivasis, have become landless. So all they require is small check dams or tanks. Second one is they don't need a huge dam. So no huge dam construction. This would be for a poor Adivasi. Because he sees that whenever such dams are built, their villages are wiped out. They have to abandon their villages and go to some other place. Now, if you list it, first one was landless rural laborers. Second, prosperous farmer from Punjab. Farmer who depends only on rain for growing crops. Rural women from land-owing family. Urban unemployed youth. Girl from rich urban family. Boy from rich urban family. Now, these are all individuals who had their goals. So the question is, people's development goals vary, explain with example, and this would be the answer. Now, on the other hand, if you look carefully, when you take any two, they will have conflicting goals. So the question is, explain how two groups may have conflicting notions of development. And to understand that, we have already seen prosperous farmer from Punjab and landless rural laborer. Now, what is conflicting? On one side, it is hardworking and cheap laborers. This is what is needed by the rich man. And the poor man requires better wages, which is the opposite of this, and more days of work. But if you take a rich person, it is less days of work because then he has to pay less. A boy, that is rich urban family, and a girl from rich urban family. One is a carefree life. Another one is a safe and liberal environment. So both are different. Third, an Adivasi from Narmada Valley and an industrialist. An Adivasi says no huge dam construction. An industrialist will say more dams and more electricity. The reason is that would be good for their industries. So these are examples of conflicting goals. Now the question, mention any three characteristics of development. First of all, different people have different development goals. Income is the most important component of development for some people. And it may be destructive for others. For development, people look at mixed goals. And besides seeking more income, people also seek things like equal treatment, freedom, security, and respect of others. Now, talking about income and other goals. So, we have understood income. What about the other goals? The requirements will be a pollution-free environment. Then it is public facilities like school, hospitals, transport, equal treatment, freedom, dignity and honor. Now, how do we measure development? When it comes to the world and different countries, they have been divided into four groups. The pink color indicates countries that are advanced. The light blue color is in transition. That is, they are moving from less developed towards advanced. The yellow ones are the less developed. Even India comes in this. And the orange is the least developed. Now, how do we compare development of different countries? In this map, we have seen different colors. Orange color is for advanced. Light blue color is for the countries that are in transition. That is, they are moving from less developed towards advanced. Then the yellow ones, even India is there, is less developed. And the orange is the least developed. Now, when I talk about income, say India, and we talk about the national income, we talk about the income of the country. We will understand it better when we understand gross national income. Now, what is gross national income? Gross national income is the value of all income produced by a country's residents, that is the people of the country. This includes both, that is citizens of the country and the foreign residents within the geographical borders, plus net receipts of income, that is in the form of wages, salary and property income from abroad that is coming into India. So in short, GNI is a measure of all money, goods, services and investments that come into or stay in the country. So can we take the GNI of different countries and say, okay, one country is developed and other one is not? So can income be a measure of development? The answer is no. Let's try to understand why. Now, different countries have different population. So comparing total income will not tell us what an average person is likely to earn. Because some countries are very big in size, some countries are very small. Say India, Japan. India's population is more, land is more. Japan, it is the other way around. So how can we compare both the countries only in terms of income? It's not possible. So we can go for an average income of a person in a country. Now, average income, let us see whether it is a measure of development. Average income, how do we get? We get it with the total income of the country divided by the total population. And this is also called per capita income. Now, according to World Development Reports 2017, countries with a per capita income of $12,056 per annum come in the category of rich countries. And the countries with a per capita income of $995 per annum comes in the category of low income countries. Now, where does India come? India is somewhere in between. And India's average income comes to $1,820 per annum. So India is put in the category of middle income countries, neither rich nor poor. This is the way the World Bank decides whether a country is developed or not. Now, we were talking about averages. Okay, averages has a drawback. It hides disparities. Let us understand. Supposing I take two countries, A and B. When it comes to A, this is their total income. And if I take an average, it comes to 10,000. But if I take the countries in the B, it also comes to 10,000. But if you see the distribution of A is almost equal. But in the B, it is not like that. B, there is unequal distribution. But averages are same. So that is why it is said that averages can hide disparities. We will not get a true picture of the country. So in which country will you be happier? Answer is obvious. It is A. Because in A, all are rich. But in B, it is not like this. So average income cannot be a measure of development. So the question, why do we use averages? Are there any limitations to their use? Illustrate with an example. Answer is, while taking total income as comparison, the total population varies from country to country. Big countries have higher value than smaller countries, like we have seen India and Japan. So averages are taken. Now, what happens when averages are taken? Averages neglect inequality. So the real situation of improvement is not reflected. And that is why averages are not useful for comparison. They hide the disparities. Now, on one hand, we have average income. On the other hand, we have other criteria. Earlier, when we looked at individual goals, we found that people not only think of average income, but they also think of other measures of development. Like they want more income, that is their primary goal, of course. But apart from that, they want liberty, respect, freedom, equal treatment, peaceful life, security. So let's compare the three states. First one, on the basis of per capita income, that is the average income. Here, Haryana is ahead. Then we take infant mortality rate per 1,000. Means, if in an area, 1,000 children are born in one given area, out of that, how many survive and how many die? The number of children who die is given here. That is 33, 10 and 38. So best is again Kerala here. Literacy rate. Literacy means anybody who knows to read and write when he has come to the age of 7 and above will be counted as literate and illiterate. And on that lines again, Kerala is ahead. Net attendance ratio per 100 persons going to secondary stage. So the age group is 14 and 15 years. So here again, it has to be Kerala. So what do we understand? Kerala is better in all areas. Only in per capita income, Haryana is better. So this tells that the people in Kerala are happy. Why are they happy? The reason is there, the public distribution system, food grains, everybody is getting. Second one is people are healthy. And third one is the education system there is better than the other states. That's why the numbers are better. So there the health facilities are better, public distribution system is better, and education is better. Now the question, money in your pocket cannot buy all the goods and services that you may need to live well, explain. Now we are ready to answer this question because money cannot buy a pollution-free environment and protect from infectious diseases. Public facilities like school, hospitals, transport, public distribution facilities again are based on demand. And money cannot buy equal treatment in the society, freedom, dignity, and honor in life. So we have a big list. This explains that money in our pocket cannot buy all the goods and services. Now, to understand health better, we have body mass index. What is body mass index? Body mass index determines a person's weight in regard to his height. It shows whether the person is overweight, underweight, or normal. Now, body mass index is equal to weight in kg upon height square. So if it is less than 18.5, then he is underweight. If it is more than 25, then it is overweight. Now we take an example. Ravi is 28 years of age and has 65 kgs of body weight and 1.4 meters tall. So find out whether he is undernourished or overweight. Answer will be, we write 65 upon 1.4 square, and answer will be, final answer will be 33.6. So we understand that he is overweight because his body mass index is more than 25. Now we come to how to measure development. We have been seeing, first we saw total income, then it was average, both of them have drawbacks. Then we have seen three states, and there we have seen some other factors also. So we have finally come to a conclusion that HDI is an attribute to measure development. Now, what's HDI? The UNDP uses a criteria called HDI to measure human development. What is UNDP? United Nations Development Program. And the Human Development Index is a statistics of three indicators used to rank countries in their level of human development. And these three factors are, first one is the gross national income per capita. When I say per capita, it is the average of the gross national income of a country. Second one is the life expectancy at birth. Life expectancy at birth means average number of years a newborn is expected to live. Third one is the mean years of schooling of people. That is average number of years of schooling of people. That is up to the age of 25 years and above. So when we take these three, first one tells about income, average income. Second one is the life expectancy. And third one is the average number of years he or she went to school. So based on that, we have a world map and the countries are divided. So HDI, how is it expressed? It is expressed in the ratio between 0 and 1. The countries that are closer to 1 are developed, and the countries that are closer to 0 are less developed. Now, we take some countries, starting with Sri Lanka. Their ranking is 76. And if I take India, our rank is 130. Pakistan, 150. Myanmar, 148. Bangladesh, 136. Now, this is out of, these numbers are out of 189 countries. And our ranking, India's ranking is 130. Which country is first then? The country that is first in the world is Norway. With an HDI, which is close to number one, that is 0.949. Explain the Human Development Index. Well, Human Development Index is a statistics of three indicators used to rank countries in the level of human development. That is gross national income per capita. Then it is life expectancy at birth. Then it is mean years of schooling of people aged 25 and above. Then what is the difference between the main criterion used by the World Bank that we have seen and the United Nations in classifying the different, in classifying different countries? When it is United Nations, it was these 3 points. That is gross national income, life expectancy at birth, and mean years of schooling of people aged 25 and above. Similarly, what about World Bank? World Bank divided the country into 2 parts. One, the countries where the per capita income is more than $12,056 per annum. And the low income countries, that is where the per capita income is less than $995 per annum. Now we understand development. Already this is done in geography, but we go through again. Sustainability of development. What is sustainability of development? Sustainability of development is, it means development should take place without damaging the environment, and development in the present should not compromise with the needs of the future generation. Now on sustainability of development, what is the question that is asked? The question is, the earth has enough resources to meet the needs of all, but not enough to satisfy the greed of even one person. How is this statement relevant to the discussion of development? Discuss. And our answer is, development does not just depend on economic factors of a country, but it also depends on resources available for the people of a country to use. Natural resources are non-renewable resources, and it is the responsibility of the people to use them only to meet their needs and not satisfy their greed. If natural resources are not used wisely now, future generation may not be able to use them for their needs, which will result in the downfall of development of the country. So it is said that the earth has enough resources to meet the needs of all, but not enough to satisfy the greed of even one person. So with this, I conclude the chapter. Thank you.